So now that we have the basics about atoms, we can build our matter into molecules, and then what we're most interested in biology are our biomolecules or macromolecules. So a molecule is two or more atoms bonded together. So when you take two or more atoms and bond them together, the bonding is going to happen using the electrons. So electrons are going to be shared, or one atom's going to take the electrons, the other one's going to give them away, and they're going to stay associated with each other. In this class, we're actually not going to learn the specific kinds of bonds, covalent bonds, ionic bonds. Again, I'm going to let a chemistry teacher teach you the details of that. But for now, I just want you to understand that the electrons are involved in holding two adjacent atoms together, and when you have two or more atoms together, you have a molecule. This is a three-dimensional model of what a molecule might look like. This is H2O, oxygen, one oxygen, two hydrogens. This is actually showing the pairs of electrons that are shared. More typically, we just draw a line to show that electrons are being shared and thus holding these two atoms together. Here are a couple examples of molecules. So oxygen gas, oxygen by itself is an element, nitrogen by itself is an element, but in nature, oxygen bonds with another oxygen to make O2, and this is two oxygens bonded together. Nitrogen gas, two nitrogen atoms will bond together. So this is an example of a molecule. This is another example of a molecule. Both of these are made coincidentally of the same, they're each the same element. Water is one oxygen bonded to two different hydrogens, so now we have a molecule made of two different elements. Now I want to clarify, sometimes people get confused. When I say element, they think of elements in poetry, like fire and water and earth. Water is not an element in a chemical way, it's a molecule. It's made of two elements, hydrogen and oxygen, bonded together. Water has a series of unique characteristics that are absolutely essential for supporting living things. And if you remember back to our very first lecture, we talked about one of the characteristics of life is that they use and require water. And if we look at an actual water molecule, we start to see where some of these unique characteristics come from. And the key thing is that it's polar. And when you say something is polar, you mean that it's got a negative side and a positive side. Something that's nonpolar isn't going to have a negative and a positive side. And this has to do with the fact that oxygen is highly electronegative. And that's a technical way of saying it really hogs its electrons. So oxygen and hydrogen here are bonded together. They're sharing an electron. But there are 8 protons in this nucleus and only 1 in this nucleus. So you can imagine the oxygen holds on to those electrons a little bit more strongly. If the electrons spend more time here, this side of the entire molecule becomes more negatively charged, and this side of the molecule becomes positively charged. It's still one big molecule, and overall it's neutral, but we have this weakly negative side and weakly positive side. Now, when water molecules line up next to each other, if we add another one, the oxygen of another one is going to line up right here, right here, and then the hydrogens are going to line up here. That's because the negative is going to be attracted to the positive. And that weak attraction between different water molecules is what we call hydrogen bonding. It's not a sharing of electrons, it's a weak attraction between different water molecules. And it's that weak attraction, those hydrogen bonds, that do all kinds of interesting things for life. One of the results of hydrogen bonding is that water is less dense as a solid than it is as a liquid. And this is something that we see every day. You put ice in your drink and it floats to the top, so it doesn't seem like a big deal. But any other kind of solid would sink in a liquid of the same kind. As you remember, kinetic energy defines what state you're in, and a solid isn't moving around as much, and so it should be able to pack more atoms and weigh more. Turns out water, as it cools down, The molecules move less and less. It gets denser and denser until 4 degrees Celsius. And as you go down to 3, 2, and 1 degree, the hydrogen bonds start to push the molecules apart a little bit, and they actually form a lattice structure that makes solid water or ice lighter. This has profound implications for ecosystems. If water didn't do this, the top layer of a pond would freeze, that ice would sink to the bottom, and then the entire pond would freeze over the winter and be a solid block of ice. Instead, what really happens is the top layer freezes, the ice stays on the top, it creates a nice layer on top of the pond, insulates the water below it, and life can persist through a cold winter or an entire ice age. Hydrogen bonding, due to the polarity of water molecules, also creates surface tension. Water is really good at holding on to itself and to other things. And you can try this if you are at home and you've got a cup of water. Stick your finger above the level of a glass of water. Try not to touch it, but get as close as you can to it. And you'll notice the water will almost come up to touch your finger, and that's surface tension. This is going to be important in moving water to the tops of trees. It's going to help liquids move through our bodies, and it's going to help water skiers float on the surface of water. It's going to help moderate temperature change. Energy that goes into heating up water has to go toward breaking hydrogen bonds and then moving molecules around. So it's going to take a lot more energy to break those bonds first and then start moving the molecules around. And we can see this in large ecosystems where if you're near the ocean, the temperature doesn't get too hot or too cold, but as you move inland, temperatures fluctuate more and more. So San Francisco doesn't get too hot, doesn't get too cold. If you come into Sacramento, up I-80, we get a lot hotter in the summer, we get a lot colder in the winter. And then if you go all the way to Reno, they have even more extremes. And this is directly related to how much water is right around that particular area. Finally, water makes really good solvent. It breaks apart other molecules nicely. And again, it's because of that polar nature, the positive side and the negative side can wiggle their way in among other molecules. And it helps facilitate chemical reactions. As it wiggles its way in there, it bumps other molecules around. And as it bumps them around, it bumps them into each other. And we'll talk about chemical reactions in a minute, but that's molecules bumping into each other. Having that liquid is going to help chemical reactions happen and help break down larger molecules so that those chemical reactions can happen. Here's a very simple example of water being a good solvent. This is NaCl, is just table salt. And so we have sodium ions and chloride ions, positive and negatively charged. And you can see how the water molecules have oriented themselves in between the positive and negative so that the salt has dissolved in the water. The parts are still present, but they're all split apart. Now they're ready to bump into each other to do different chemical reactions. As you watch this video about water, pay attention to where the researcher that's shown right here is from. I think it's interesting to note who is doing this work on understanding life and water.